नेशन
डिमिनेशन
ओके ट्रांसमिनेशन डिमिनेशन और क्या पढ़ा
मेटाबॉलिज्म ऑफ अमोनिया
मेटाबॉलिज्म ऑफ अमोनिया हाउ इट इज इन दैट मेटाबॉलिज्म व्हाट वी लर्न
डिस्पोजल ऑफ अमोनिया एंड टॉक्सिसिटी ऑफ अमोनिया
ओके सो कैन व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट पाथवेज बाय व्हिच अमोनिया इज सिंथेसाइज्ड इन आवर बॉडी कैन एनीवन टेल मी कैसे बनता है
oxidative deamination
so oxidative deamination of amino acid okay so is this the only oxidative deamination or there is a different kind of deamination process sip oxidative hota hai ke deamination
no ma'am
okay so what are the different process or type non oxidative deamination bhi hota hai na
yes
ma'am
Yes.
ठीक है सो ओके इज इट ओनली लाइक ओनली सोर्स फ्रॉम विच वी गेट अमोनिया तो फिर और कहाँ कहाँ से मिलता है
एक्शन ऑफ इंटेस्टाइनल बैक्टीरिया
ऑन यूरिया यस और कहाँ से
कैटाबॉलिज्म ऑफ
न्यूक्लियोटाइड्स
यस कैटाबॉलिज्म ऑफ न्यूक्लियोटाइड और
Catabolism of biogenic amines.
Biogenic amines. Okay, so these are the four factors from which we get ammonia. Now, ammonia is toxic, hai na? So it should not be, it can't be kept in the free form. Otherwise, it will get absorbed in the blood and cause a toxicity. Mostly it's the brain. So how it is transported from one organ to other? How it is transported? What are the transport form of ammonia?
Glutamine and alanine.
हाँ तो glutamine कहाँ कहाँ से आता है? From where we get glutamine?
Liver, brain, intestine.
Intestine. And from where we get alanine?
Muscles.
Mostly. Okay. These are the two transport form. So glutamine, mostly it is majority of the glutamine form in the brain, but we get glutamine formation liver and intestine. Muscle may it is transported in the form. It actually this ammonia is fixed in the form of alanine, and this alanine is transported. And apart from this, few free ammonia is also there. Okay, this ammonia is disposed there. So we have seen formation. We have seen how it is transported. Now it is finally disposed of. मतलब body से बाहर कैसे निकलता है? So how do we get excretion of ammonia and in which form?
Urea.
कौन से? Can you repeat please? एक यूरिया बताएं और कहाँ होता है? Uric acid. यूरिक एसिड और यूरिया का ये नहीं है बेटा यूरिक एसिड इज फॉर्म्ड एज अ प्रोडक्ट ऑफ न्यूक्लियोटाइड मेटाबॉलिज्म ओके एनी अदर सो मेजॉरिटी इट इज एक्सक्रीटेड इन द यूरिन इन द फॉर्म ऑफ यूरिया बट इवन फ्री अमोनिया इज ऑल्सो एक्सक्रीटेड टू सम एक्सटेंट वेरी लेस एंड अपार्ट फ्रॉम इट इट इज एक्सक्रीटेड थ्रू द स्वेट फिसेस वी हैव सीन एंड दिस अमोनिया इज ऑल्सो यूटिलाइज How it is utilized in our body? Can you tell me how it is utilized? Though major part of ammonia is excreted in the form of urea, but ammonia has some significance too. So how it is utilized in our body?
For formation of non-essential amino acids?
Yes, formation of
for acid-base balance.
Yes, ammonia is used by kidney acid-base balance. Yes, or
of urea
amino sugar
yes synthesis of
urine pyrimidines
okay glutamate is also synthesized from the ammonia glutamine is also synthesized okay so this is the ammonia metabolism you should know how it is formed okay when we mostly it is a product. That's why it is formed from the protein. What we eat, either protein catabolism in our body, it is transported in the form of glutamine, alanine, and then finally it has to be disposed of. So major route of ammonia disposal in our body is the for urea, synthesis of urea. मुझे बताइए, मैंने intoxication लिया था क्या, ammonia intoxication last time?
Yes ma'am.
Yes ma'am.
Yes, हो गया
yes,
था ना? Okay. So again I'll share my screen rather than uploading PPT because last time you had problem. Okay. So let me share my screen. Okay. Can you see screen? Screen दिख रही है आपको?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we know that urea is the major. You can see the final product by which ammonia can be excreted from the body. Our body gets rid of ammonia most of the by formation of urea. Now the urea cycle, it is also known as a Krebs-Hanslet cycle. But here I would like to raise an alarm. Remember, it's a Krebs-Hanslet cycle. It's not a Krebs cycle. When I say Krebs cycle, what comes in your mind?
Glucose metabolism.
Glucose metabolism. What is another name for Krebs cycle?
TCA cycle.
Okay, or citric acid cycle. So please do not confuse urea cycle, that is a Krebs-Hanslet cycle, with the Krebs cycle. Okay, now urea cycle is a major route of detoxification of ammonia, which occurs in the liver. Now you have to remember the organ is very, very important. You get MCQ on this. The urea cycle occurs in which organ? So it is it occurs only in the liver. Why it is so, we'll see as we go as we'll advance. Now remember, there are the steps which are, there are 5 steps in the urea cycle. Out of that, in the cell, in the liver cell, first 2 steps, it occurs in the mitochondria. Well, remaining cells, they are taken care in the cytosol. Okay. Now this reaction or this cycle was first elucidated by Krebs and Krebs-Hanslet. That's why it is named as a Krebs-Hanslet cycle. Okay. I again repeat, it's not a TCA cycle. Now, as we know that there are 5 steps. Out of this, 2 steps are in the mitochondria, and remaining steps are they are carried in the cytosol. Now, when we say that this is the major route of detoxification of ammonia, so it has to start from ammonia. Now, ammonia, we have discussed the different pathway. From the 4 pathways, we get ammonia is produced in our body, and it is produced almost in every cell. It is transported in the liver through the glutamine and alanine, and in the liver, it enters in this urea cell. कहाँ से आता है कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड?
Krebs cycle.
So cellular Krebs cycle, and if you can see, it is through the electron transport chain. So we get carbon dioxide almost in every cell as a result of cellular metabolism and cellular respiration. So this carbon dioxide, it combines with ammonia, and there is a formation of carbamoyl phosphate. Now which kind of reaction you can observe here? ये कैसी रिएक्शन है?
Irreversible reaction.
Irreversible. So you can see arrow has a only head. This is very, very important. This is a irreversible reaction, and you can see this as it is a synthesis is going on. Carbamoyl phosphate, the enzyme is with help of ATP. So enzyme is named as a carbamoyl phosphate. Synthetase one, and it requires 2 ATP. 2 ATPs are converted into to ADP and PI, and these phosphate bonds are utilized for the synthesis of carbamoyl phosphate. Now you have to remember that this enzyme, carbamoyl phosphate synthase 1, okay, this is a mitochondrial enzyme. There is another enzyme of the same name, that is a carbamoyl phosphate synthase 2, but that is a cytosolic enzyme. And that enzyme, you will learn that enzyme in the synthesis of nucleotide. Okay, so remember carbamoyl phosphate synthase 1 likhna bahut zaruri hai, otherwise there is 2 also. Okay, so you have to specify this enzyme is carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1. Now you can see NAG, this is N-acetylglutamine, this is an activator which is required for this process, and you can see this in N-acetylglutamate also allosterically regulated. So its presence is one of the regulatory factor for this reaction. Okay, so you can see this as if this is a reversible step. So this is very, very important test as it is a regulatory step of urea cycle. Okay, so you may get 3 mark question on the first step of urea cycle, or ye university mein aaya bhi hai. Okay, so that's the importance of this step. So you have to mention from where you get this ammonia, carbon dioxide, which is an enzyme, how it is different from carbamoyl phosphate synthase 2, and that is even that's a MCQ. Okay, and then 2 ATPs are required, and activator is required, that is N-acetylglutamine. We will see how it regulates in the regulation of urea cycle. Now carbamoyl phosphate, which is formed here, you can see it is now it reacts with the ornithine. Ornithine is the non-standard amino acid. It is formed during the urea cycle. Now this ornithine, it is synthesized in the cytosol. It is transported in the mitochondria. Now in mitochondria, you can see the carbamoyl group of this carbamoyl phosphate is transported to the ornithine, and we get synthesis of citrulline. An enzyme which carries this reaction is known as ornithine transcarbamoylase, as it is transferring carbamoyl group. So we get synthesis of citrulline. Ab ye citrulline kahan synthesized hua hai? Where you find this synthesis of citrulline going on?
Mitochondria.
Okay. Aur baki bachi hui steps kahan hone wali hai? Remaining 3 steps. Where you will get cytosol. To kya karna padega? This citrulline has to be transported out from the mitochondria. So there is a one enzyme, you can see citrulline translocase, which translocate the citrulline from the mitochondria to the cytosol. But many of the books, this translocase has not this enzyme is not included in the enzyme of urea cycle. Okay, so you should have the knowledge, but you don't count that enzyme. Isliye maine likha bhi nahi hai. Now you can see this citrulline when it in cytoplasm, it is you can see it is converted into arginosuccinate. Now this citrulline, citrulline is combined with aspartate. Now aspartate kya hai ye? What is aspartate?
Oxalic acid.
Aspartate, yes, it is formed from the oxaloacetic acid. It is an amino acid. It is a standard amino acid. Main ye kyun puch rahi hu? Kyunki you can see that in the product of this urea cycle, there are non-standard amino acid and standard amino acid. So you should know. Like this citrulline is a non-standard amino acid. Now it combines with aspartate. Now aspartate kahan se aata hai? We get it is synthesized by transamination of oxaloacetate. Or ye oxaloacetate kahan rehta hai? From where you get oxaloacetate? Do you remember the first step of PCA cycle? Oxaloacetate rehta na? So from this oxaloacetate of PCA cycle, on transamination you get aspartate. Now this citrulline combined with aspartate, now you get synthesis of arginosuccinate. Now here again, this is a synthetic reaction. So you get ATP is converted into AMP and PPI, and you get synthesis of arginosuccinate. Now arginosuccinate, once it is formed, it gets cleaved. It is cleaved with help of enzyme arginosuccinase, or we can call it as a arginosuccinase lyase. Okay, so now these enzyme cleave arginosuccinate into arginine and fumarate. Okay, so fumarate kaha hai, can you remember, recall the link of fumarate or TCA cycle mein kahi banta hai ke fumarate?
Yes, ma'am.
So this fumarate, yes, you can see, it is formed in the, kaunsa cycle mein ban raha hai? Urea cycle mein, but it is going to the TCA cycle. Okay, so this fumarate which is released, it goes in the TCA cycle and arginine is formed here. Now arginine, it is now again, it is cleaved into ornithine and urea by the enzyme arginase. Now remember, the speciality of this arginase is that this arginase is present only in the liver cell. That's why urea cycle occurs only in the liver, not in other tissues. Okay, हमने पहले ही बोला था ना, यूरिया साइकिल के लिए ऑर्गन इज इंपॉर्टेंट बिकॉज दिस अकर्स ओनली इन द लीवर सेल. नाउ व्हाई इट इज सो, बिकॉज आर्जिनेज एंजाइम इज प्रेजेंट ओनली इन द लीवर सेल, सो वी गेट सिंथेसिस ऑफ यूरिया एंड यू कैन सी ऑर्निथिन इज रीफॉर्म्ड. सो वी कैन, इफ यू थिंक इन अदर वे, लाइक ऑर्निथिन इज यूटिलाइज इन दिस रिएक्शन whole cycle and it is also reformed in this cycle. So you can see it acts as a mere catalyst. It doesn't take part, but it acts as a catalyst catalyst for the urea cycle. So this is the importance of ornithine here, and you can see that we get the synthesis of urea. Now urea, once it is synthesized in the liver cell, it is excreted in the majority of it is excreted in the through the kidney in urine, and a few amount it is excreted in the feces through the intestine. Now you can see in this diagram, what is this green part, and green part jo hai maine alag se dikhaya hai. Now how it is differentiated from the Krebs cycle, ye green part ke jo bhi component hai ye kahan ka hai, where you get this all component, like fumarate is converted into malate, malate is converted into oxaloacetate,
so you can see
this is urea cycle, though we call Krebs Hensley cycle is not a Krebs cycle, but you can see this cycle is related to the Krebs cycle. How it is related, can you tell me how it is related? The link is shown in the slide, just you have to put into word. How it is related, you can say aspartate, which can be formed from the oxaloacetate in TCA cycle, it is utilized in the urea cycle, while you can see fumarate, which is synthesized in the urea cycle, it would be, iska kya hoga, it is entering
utilized
in the
TCA
cycle. So it is utilized in the TCA cycle. So this is a correlation of the urea cycle with the TCA cycle. Now you can see when this fumarate is converted into malate, what is the enzyme? Do you remember what is the enzyme here? Kaun sa enzyme rehta hai?
Isomerase.
And when malate, what is the enzyme which can which convert malate into oxaloacetate?
Dehydrogenase.
Kaun sa dehydrogenase? You can see malate dehydrogenase is enzyme. Okay, and this malate dehydrogenase, it uses NAD. So you can see NAD is converted into NADH, and this NADH, what's the significance of NADH? क्या होगा NADH का? It will enter in the electron transport chain. And how many ATPs will form? How many ATPs will form from one NADH to 0.5? Okay. So you can see, as it is this fumarate which is it is linked with the fumarate is a product of urea cycle. it is also synthesizing the 2.5 ATP through this maltate dehydrogenase. Okay. So if we count energetic here, can you tell me how many ATPs are utilized here and how many ATPs are synthesized? कितने एटीपी यूटिलाइज हुए हैं?
थ्री
फोर एटीपी कंज्यूम
क्यू फोर एटीपी थ्री और फोर थ्री और फोर अच्छा थ्री वाले बताओ क्यू थ्री और फोर वाले बताओ क्यू फोर यू कैन रेज योर हैंड्स वाई थ्री और वाई फोर कुछ भी तो होगा ना दिस इज नॉट अ एग्जाम यू कैन आंसर रॉन्ग ऑल्सो क्योंकि
कार्बोमाइड फॉस्फेट सिंथेटेस के लिए दो एटीपी
यस दो एटीपी लगे टू एटीपी सारी
और फिर आर्जिनोसक्सिनेट के लिए और दो एटीपी
वहां तो लेकिन एक ही एटीपी है ना बेटा Okay. So yes, it's true that you can see here, it's clearly two ATPs are utilized in the first step of urea cycle. But here you can see in the second step that arginosuccinate synthase, you can get ATP is converted into AMP and PPI, pyrophosphate bond. That means there is a cleavage of two high phosphate energy bond. So it can be considered as a utilization of four ATP. Okay, now for energetic system, we have seen utilization. And how many ATPs are synthesized in the urea cycle? How many ATPs are synthesized? We have discussed now. Bhavisha, how many ATPs are synthesized? 2.5 ATPs are synthesized through the TCA cycle. Okay, so one NADH which enters in the fumarate which enters in TCA cycle is leads to the synthesis of 2.5. So how much of net gain or utilization of ATP? कैसे ये endergonic लग रहा है कि exergonic लग रही reaction? अगर हम plus minus calculate करेंगे तो ATPs are utilized or ATPs are synthesized from the urea cycle?
Utilized. How many?
1.5.
Yes, so you have to remember that. So this is a urea cycle. It requires ATP. It utilizes ATP. While TCA cycle, it forms ATP. Per turn of TCA cycle, how many ATPs we get?
24.
10. Per turn of TCA cycle. 12. Purani baat hai. 12 purani baat hai. Now 10. Okay. ठीक है 24 यू मस्ट बी थिंकिंग इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ ग्लूकोज ओके सो यू कैन सी दिस इज वेरी सिंपल साइकिल वेरी स्मॉल ओनली 5 स्टेप्स आउट ऑफ दिस 2 स्टेप्स आर इन माइटोकॉन्ड्रिया 3 स्टेप्स आर इन द साइटोसोल एंड यू कैन सी इट इज लिंक्ड विद द टीसीए साइकिल ओके नाउ यू कैन सी देर आर ओनली 2 स्टैंडर्ड अमीनो एसिड विच आर टेकिंग पार्ट इन दिस यूरिया साइकिल कौन से है दो स्टैंडर्ड
aspartate
and arginine okay arginine. And remaining one like ornithine citrulline arginosuccinate these are also amino acids but they are non standard amino acids okay so you can see Okay. So the urea which is formed, it is excreted in the kidney and in intestine. We have seen that from the urease is an enzyme which cleaves this intestinal, which cleaves urea into carbon dioxide and ammonia. This ammonia now it is excreted in the blood and it is also excreted in the feces. Now five enzymes are involved here. And amino acid, total six are involved. We have seen like two protein, arginine and aspartic acid, and three NPN like ornithine, citrulline and arginosuccinic acid. And one activator, that is the N-acetylglutamine, is required. Now energetics also we have seen, like there is utilization of four high phosphate energy bond, two for the CPS1 synthesis and one for... Okay, two bonds for arginosuccinate synthesis. However, 2.5 ATP is formed from the fumarate. So, total consumption of urea cycle, it is 1.5 ATP per cycle. Now, final reaction can be summarized as it takes part ammonia, reacts with carbon dioxide, then one molecule of aspartate, 3 ATP, but 4 bonds are cleaved. Now, it leads to the formation of urea, fumarate, 2 ADP, 2 PI, 1 MP and 1 PPI. So, this is the final reaction of urea cycle. Now, remember, dear students, that even this urea cycle, it is asked as a 3-mark question for just draw and diagram. So, remember, when you draw the diagram, your labeling should be proper. Cytosol, mitochondria, likhna padega. Every ATP and all enzymes should be written. You can skip this part. Jo green color ka part jo hai baki, wo aap skip kar sakte ho. But remaining diagram, whole diagram and well labeled diagram should be written. Anyway, if you are in writing any diagram or any flow chart in the exam, remember that you have to label it properly. Otherwise, it carries no meaning. Okay. So this is the urea cycle. Now we will see how the regulation of urea cycle. So which is the first step of the urea cycle is the regulatory step. And the enzyme which regulates this step is known as a carbamoyl phosphate synthase 1. Okay, 1 likhna bahut zaruri hai. Now how it is regulated? It is regulated with the activator, that is the N-acetylglutamate. Now, synthesis of N-acetylglutamate, you can see it is synthesized from the acetyl-CoA, which combined with glutamate with help of enzyme energy synthesis, you get synthesis of N-acetylglutamate. And this N-acetylglutamate also after few time, it is hydrolyzed by energy hydrolase to glutamate and acetate. Okay, so you can see this CPS1 synthesis, it depends on N-acetylglutamate. And how this the synthesis of N-acetylglutamate is regulated. Okay. So you can see the synthesis of N-acetylglutamate, it is activated by arginine, glutamine, and high protein diet. You can see these are the conditions when availability of amino acid is more, and even in that condition, presence of high protein diet, it will stimulate synthesis of NAG, and that's why this N-acetylglutamate will stimulate the enzyme CPS1 and urea cycle will be accelerated. And this you can see feed forward regulation. Isko kya bolte hai? Khud ko, like it is like activating oneself. So it is a feed forward regulation. And I think I'll advise you all when you are at home. So this feed forward regulation, you should acclimatize, or you should accept this feed forward regulation for you, and please motivate yourself for the studies. Okay, because final exam jo hogi, that would not be online in any case, and you need to make your brain smart, not either your laptop or not your mobiles. Okay, so please feed all this knowledge into your brain, not anywhere else. Okay, so you can use this feed forward regulation, motivate yourself, just like energy, it is stimulated by arginine, glutamine and high protein diet. So this is a regulation of urea cycle. Okay, now we have seen this relationship between TC and urea cycle, but just we will revise. Now as you can see, this TC cycle and urea cycle is interlinked. So even this both of these two cycle, they are together can be called as a urea bicycle. Okay. So you can see in urea cycle, fumarate is formed here. In TCA cycle, fumarate is consumed by malate and oxaloacetate. Now you can see aspartate is synthesized in the TCA cycle from oxaloacetate, and same is utilized in the urea cycle. Carbon dioxide, it is utilized in the urea cycle while it is synthesized in the TCA cycle. Here urea cycle, it needs 1.5 ATP, while TCA cycle 10 ATPs are generated. So you can see this is the what you can see how the urea bicycle occurs. Now coming to the disorders of urea cycle, if you are asked the long question, so you most of the time you get an add a note on the urea cycle disorder. Okay, so this is the urea cycle again in total. Now remember that any disorder of urea cycle, mostly it is because of the deficiency of one of the enzyme, or it either this enzyme is deficient or defective. Okay, then anywhere if what happened, like if the enzyme is defective, so kya hoga, what will happen? Just take an example, like carbamoyl phosphate synthase is deficient. So kya hoga? Just have a guess. Because iske baad hum jo bhi disorder sikhne wale hai, like this is the urea cycle, the aromatic amino acid disorder, all these are known as inborn errors of metabolism. Now inborn errors of metabolism, it stands for defect in the synthesis of enzyme. And mostly this enzyme, what will happen, you can see whenever this enzyme is defective. Okay, to kya hoga, just have a guess. Take an example that this in the first day, bolo, can you repeat please? What will happen?
The further product may be disturbed.
Yes. So you can see in any the step, you can see all are irreversible step. So whenever one in any enzyme is deficient, so what will happen? This product will be deficient because it will not form. At the same time, what will happen to this reactant or substrate? Uska kya hoga? Product to form nahi hoga, so we'll get deficiency of product. Yes, so you can see this the reactors or substrate will accumulate in the tissue, and then it comes in the blood and finally excreted in the urine, and then it is known as a that will leads to the excretion of that compound in the urine. Okay, so urea cycle disorder mostly because of deficiency or defective enzyme of this pathway, like carbamoyl phosphate synthase 1, ornithine transcarbamylase, arginosuccinate synthase, then arginosuccinase and this arginase. Okay, now carbamoyl phosphate synthase, this is synthetase. Okay, remember, now whenever this enzyme is deficient, okay, so what will happen, kya hoga? Which things will accumulate here?
CO2 and NH3.
Yes, CO2 and NH2 will accumulate. Carbon dioxide and ammonia will accumulate. And you know that ammonia is very toxic. Okay, so it this hyperammonemia, there will be hyperammonemia, which will generally manifest in the form of urea, excessive vomiting. Okay, and then because of this, you get the delirium, tremors. So this all excessive talking, okay, blurring of vision, slurring of speech, and then sometime it may be convulsion, and that lead to the toxicity of the brain, which is known as the encephalopathy. Okay, so mostly the disorder of urea cycle, they are autosomal recessive, that transported in the autosomal recessive manner. Exception is one, and there is a hyperammonemia you get, then encephalopathy, and because of this excessive ammonia, there is a respiratory alkalosis. So patient hyperventilate more, so that leads to the respiratory alkalosis. Okay, so you get in the what happened in first step, first disorder, is because of deficiency of carbamoyl phosphate synthesis. And this is known as a hyperammonemia type 1. Now you can see as the defect is very close to the to the ammonia. In this defect, we get it is very dangerous condition. We'll get hyperammonemia to maximum extent, and that lead to the encephalopathy. Such patients are you can see they die within the 1 year of birth. Okay. Now second is the when the enzyme ornithine transcarbamoylase is deficient. What will happen? This disorder is known as a hyperammonemia type 2. Now in this disorder, what will happen? This citrullin will not form and we get increased level of ornithine in the blood. So we get the ornithine urea. Even there is a rise in the glutamine level in the blood. Okay, so this is the deficiency of ornithine transcarbamoylase. Disorder is known as hyperammonemia type 2. You can see these two disorders are dangerous because you get this very the ammonia in the free form, as these are very close to the ammonia. So we get the hyperammonia more in the quantity as compared to other disorders. Now, if we come to the third disorder, which is known as the hyperornithemia. Now, hyperornithemia, it is a disorder because due to deficiency of the this transporter protein. We have discussed this ornithine. It is synthesized in the cytoplasm and it has to be transported into the mitochondria. And there is a transporter. When there is a transporter protein is deficient, this leads to the hyperornithemia. And that is that leads to the triple H syndrome. We will see in later. Here you can get the arginosuccinase is deficient. When this arginosuccinate enzyme is deficient, we can get, you can see here citrulline will accumulate in the blood. It will be excreted in the urine and you will get citrullinemia and citrullinuria also. Now another enzyme is whenever this arginosuccinase is deficient, we call it as arginosuccinic acid urea. And here, because arginosuccinate is not cleaved, it will be in level will high in the blood, and that is this is known as arginosuccinic acid urea. Now when arginase is deficient, we get disease is a hyperarginemia, and this hyperarginemia is again because there is increased excretion of arginine. Now, if you compare these two disorders, hyperammonemia type 1 and type 2 is more dangerous as compared to other. So here you can see what are the table where you get the symptoms and enzyme involved. So type 1 and type 2 is again because there is increased level of ammonia. Okay. Increased level of ammonia, and because of encephalopathy, we get mental retardation in hyperammonemia type 2. Here you can see ornithine whenever there is a deficiency of ornithine transcarbamoylase in hyperammonemia type 2, you get there is increased level of ammonia. But apart from that, we get the increased level of carbamoyl phosphate. Now this carbamoyl phosphate is utilized for the synthesis of the pyrimidine. So that's why we get the increased level of orotic acid, which is the catabolic product of pyrimidine. So we get the increase in the level of orotic acid urea, and this is the along with that, there is an increase in the glutamine level. Now hyperornithemia, because of defective this is known as the triple H syndrome, where we get hyperornithemia, hyperammonemia, and homocitrullinemia. Okay, this is the only disorder which is it is X-linked disorder. Now citrullinemia, it is deficiency of arginosuccinate synthase. We get increased level of ammonia and citrulline in the blood. Now arginosuccinic acid urea is because of arginosuccinate lyase. There is increased arginosuccinic acid level in the blood and urine, and you get the metabolic acidosis because this is the acid. And we get trichorexis. Trichorexis means there is a dry nodes on the skin, which are very dry. Trichorexis nodosa, which is the manifestation in the skin. Now, hyperarginemia is deficiency of arginase level. We get increased level of arginine in the CSF as well as urine, and it is also associated with arginanemia and arginine urea. Okay, so you have to remember this as a desired disorder, because you most of the time you get the short note if urea cycle is asked as a long question. Now, urea cycle disorder, we have seen that the signs symptoms would be more of ammonia intoxication, encephalitis, and respiratory alkalosis, and you get the symptoms like protein induced vomiting, intermittent ataxia, irritability, lethargy, and EMA, mental retardation, all because of ammonia intoxicity on the blood. So what are the investigation we will do? We will see for the rest blood ammonia level, plasma amino acid level will all excreted. We can see even we can identify the plasma amino acid level, and we get raised urinary organic acid excretion, and because of acidosis blood pH will be low and PCO2 will be high. Now management is that you have to give thus when ammonium ions are not converted into citrulline and arginine, it is converted into glycine and glutamine. Agar ye aage nahi ja raha hai, to take the alternative pathway, and these are converted into glycine and glutamine. So glycine and glutamine, because so what we can chelate this glycine and glutamine. So we use sodium benzoate, which combines with glycine to form heparin, and then phenyl butyrate, which combined with glutamine to form phenyl acetyl glutamine. So these are the chelating agent which can use for the to manage urea cycle disorder. Okay, we'll skip this. Now, as you don't have the blood urea practical, you should know what is the importance of blood urea. For MBBS, we have a whole practical for them. So we can skip this here, but this is very important because even it's like a general knowledge question. You should know what are the renal blood urea. It is the one of the investigations which is used to assess renal function. So normally blood urea level are within 10 to 40 milligram per dl. You can see. And in the urine, it is 15 to 30 gram per day. So you can see how it is a difference. In blood, it remains in the milligram, while in the urine, it is excreted in gram. That much of urea is excreted. Now, whenever there is any obstruction in the excretion of urea, that leads to the increased level of blood urea in the patient. Now, there are two terminology you have to remember. One is uremia and one is azotemia. Now, uremia, remember there is no word like a hyperuremia. Hum glucose ko bolte na, hyperglycemia. High protein ko hum hyperproteinemia we call it. So, there is no word like hyperuremia. We just call uremia. So, remember that. So, uremia, you get increase in the blood level, and mostly when there is blood urea level is increased because of renal failure. When there is any pathology in kidney which is obstructing excretion of urea in through the urine, it is known as a uremia. While azotemia is another terminology which is used frequently. Okay, so ye kya hota hai? This is an increase in the blood urea concentration. Not only blood urea, we get other metabolites. Jaise humne dekhe na, it can be arginosuccinic acid or it can be a citrulline. So you get nitrogen metabolite irrespective of associated renal disorder. So most of the time this is because of the urea cycle disorder. So causes, now let's see what are the causes of blood increased level of blood urea. Now it can be pre-renal, renal, and post-renal. So pre-renal, there would be increase in the protein breakdown. More protein would be broken down, so that will lead to more formation of urea that may occur in the surgery. If there is a prolonged fever or thyrotoxicosis, you get increase in the protein breakdown. Now, in renal condition, you get like if there is a renal condition, there is a decrease in the filtration of urea through the glomerulus. So you the conditions like acute glomerulonephritis, chronic glomerulonephritis, and nephrosclerosis, these are the causes of renal uremia. Now, post-renal is the obstruction in the urinary tract you get. Okay. So this was about the urea. Now we up till now we have done with the general metabolic reaction of the protein. We had started with the digestion and absorption, then we saw how the proteins, amino acids are catabolized. So first step was transamination, then deamination. Deamination, oxidative, non-oxidative. Then there is a formation of ammonia. Ammonia was utilized by what was synthesized in different organs, transported in the form of glutamine, alanine. And finally, it enters in the liver where it is detoxified into the urea. And urea is which is formed in the liver, it is transported in the kidney, and in kidney it is excreted in the urine. Okay, and to some extent this is also excreted through the feces. So this was a major, you can see, general reaction of the protein, or you can see amino acid. Okay, now we are going to the second section of protein metabolism, where we are going to learn the disorders related to individual amino acid. Okay, before we now, you are lucky students that you don't have whole reactions or whole pathway in your course. In your syllabus, it is very specifically written that the disorders of aromatic amino acid and transmethylation reaction, synthesis of creatinine, and then one carbon metabolism. So hence onward, we will take just whatever in your syllabus is given. We are not going into detail. So iske liye, that's why I will advise you to keep your books ready. Or books mein aap mark karo aapko kya kya hai. Jo main padhaungi, that is in your course. Remaining things are not in your course. Otherwise, protein metabolism is very, very vast. So we will focus on disorders more, not in the pathway. Clear? Clear? हाँ बोलो. हाँ
yes,
ओके
ठीक
है. ठीक है, तो बिफोर वी गो फॉर इंडिविजुअल अमाइनो एसिड, देयर इज समथिंग यू हैव स्टडीड दिस इन द प्रोटीन केमिस्ट्री ऑल्सो. ओके, इन प्रोटीन लाइक इन सॉरी इन अमाइनो एसिड वी हैड यू मस्ट हैव सीन द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ अमाइनो एसिड बेस्ड ऑन द मेटाबॉलिक फेट. डू यू रिमेंबर दैट क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ अमाइनो एसिड बेस्ड ऑन द मेटाबॉलिक फेट? याद है क्या? नहीं याद? कैसे रहते हैं? केटोजेनिक, ग्लूकोजेनिक, कुछ याद है वर्ड्स? ओके, भूल गए आप. आर यू स्टडिंग फॉर योर एग्जाम विच आई हैड अनाउंस इन द फर्स्ट वीक ऑफ जून? पढ़ रहे हो कि नहीं? हेलो.
यस मैम.
क्या बताया था? yes, क्या कोर्स बताया था मैंने? क्या कोर्स बताया था?
मेटाबॉलिज्म ऑफ प्रोटीन, कार्बोहाइड्रेट्स एंड लिपिड्स.
लिपिड्स, चलो उसका तो याद है. ठीक है, ओके. तो ओके, तो हमने जो अप टिल नाउ व्हाट एवर वी हैव सीन, हमने देखा कि अमोनिया का क्या होता है ना. सो वी हैव सीन how ammonia is transported, utilized. But what about the remaining part of amino acid, which is known as a carbon skeleton? Okay, so here is a short diagram. You can see this is a fate of carbon skeleton. Now you can see like this is all the amino acid. They are related with the TCA cycle. They enter in the TCA cycle through some part, and then it takes its own pathway. Okay, so here you can see now there are few amino acids like which are converted into, mostly you can see the which are, I have shown it in the red, they are the glucogenic amino acid. Now why they are glucogenic amino acid? You can see they are either converted into pyruvate or either converted into one of the product of the TCA cycle. And we know that this all things from the pyruvate, all these all amino acids, they can enter in the gluconeogenesis through this pathway, phosphoenol. So these all amino acids are the glucogenic amino acid. ठीक है, ये diagram आप देख सकते हो. This is in the Satyanarayan also. Okay, so now there are amino acids which are shown in the yellow form. Okay, so you can see these are converted to acetyl CoA, And this few amino acids, they are converted into acetoacetyl-CoA. Okay. So mostly these are the ketogenic amino acid. So because acetyl-CoA is a product of ketone. Okay. Or acetoacetyl, these are also, this leads to the converted acetyl-CoA and ultimately it forms the ketone. So the amino acid which are shown in the yellow, they are ketogenic amino acid. Okay. अब मुझे ये बताइए, कैन यू फाइंड सेम नेम, कॉमन नेम विच आर प्रेजेंट इन येलो एंड रेड ऑल्सो? है क्या?
आइसोल्यूसिन.
कौन सा? आइसोल्यूसिन. आइसोल्यूसिन इज अ केटोजेनिक एंड ग्लूकोजेनिक ऑल्सो.
यस मैम.
Okay, so do you find all these amino acid in all yellow boxes? They are present in red also?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
Sare nahi hai. Not all.
Kaun se nahi hai? Phir batao.
Lysine.
Leucine नहीं है यहाँ. नहीं है, नहीं है. Let's see. नहीं है, नहीं है. Okay, ठीक है. Leucine. और कौन सा नहीं है?
Lysine
भी नहीं है. है क्या? ढूंढो. No. Okay. So these two amino acid, you remember that leucine and lysine, these are only ketogenic amino acid. Okay. So better way to remember the metabolic fate or the classification of amino acid depending on the metabolic fate, you just remember first the amino acid which are only ketogenic, and these are 2L. So ek is leucine and lysine. Then you can remember the amino acid which are present in both pathway, both glucogenic as well as ketogenic. So these are, can you tell me the amino acid which are ketogenic as well as glucogenic?
Tryptophan,
isoleucine, tryptophan,
phenylalanine,
tyrosine. Tyrosine. Okay. So PITT you can remember. So these are the amino acids which are which have ketogenic as well as glucogenic. अब जो बचे हुए amino acid है उनको पूरा
glucogenic.
दो glucogenic. Okay. So this is how you can remember the fate of carbon skeleton. That's why amino acids, they are glucogenic and ketogenic. Okay. Thank you.